There are many people who deserve to be called true heroes of the movement for immigration law enforcement and common sense immigration reforms. And one of those are the leaders of local, state, and national grassroots immigration groups. These people dedicate a good portion of their lives recruiting other activists, leading citizen petition drives, organizing demonstrations, speaking out at local government meetings, speaking to the media, all the while operating on a shoestring while fighting lavishly funded organs of the open borders movement like the ACLU, La Raza, the Southern Poverty Law Center, and all the George Soros-funded spinoffs. They also have to contend with hostile government agencies, hostile judges, and hostile local media. Yet still they persist because they love their country and they want to preserve its freedoms for future generations of Americans. So it's an honor to have two of those heroes with us today to share their stories from the front lines and tell us about their battles in the grassroots trenches. And I'd ask them both to come up here and sit at the podium. Robin Hvidston. Robin Hvidston is a co-founder and executive director of We the People Rising, a grassroots organization based in Southern California, and she's the California director for the Remembrance Project.
Our organization is very active social media-wise. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and we have a very active YouTube channel. So we are able to videotape our activism, and then we can spread that across the nation and even the world. Our primary followers are in California. Probably next is Texas. But we have a follower in Sweden. Mr. Lars Anderson watches what we're doing in California. And just a couple of weeks ago, we picked up a follower in England, Leslie Smith. So it's very exciting to know that we can share our activism with the world using YouTube. I am also the California State Director for the Remembrance Project. And probably a lot of you in this room are familiar with that organization. Tim Ling, looks like he's not here, is the co-founder. And Tim, could you stand up? The Remembrance Project honors American citizens who lost their lives at the hands of those illegally in our country. And we have one of our family members, Mr. Trenchant, could you stand up? He lost his beautiful daughter. He is one of the spokespeople for the Remembrance Project. He has testified in Congress and has had a lot of media influence. And that brings me to the other co-founder, Maria Espinosa. She is the most amazing woman. Through her vision, she was able to connect with then-candidate Donald Trump. And we were lucky enough to meet with Donald Trump backstage via the Remembrance Project. And it was so exciting. We got to meet with him 5 times because of Maria Espinosa's diligence. And he is a very creative thinker, because he would meet us backstage. I'm going to show you a little clip. We had our Stone Lives quilts. He would always bring us out on stage with him. So it was very exciting. Fred, could you show that first clip? This is in Las Vegas backstage with candidate Trump.
Yes, I know most of them. Yes, I know. I met the families. so sad.
Yes.
This guy's with me. He's my
Absolutely.
Man.
Absolutely.
Yeah. How we doing?
Mr. President, how are you?
We have the polls like 41%.
I love it.
We're all with you, Mr. Trump.
Thank you, darling.
You get my half right?
Yeah, sure. You go.
You're our hero.
Mr. Trump told them to ban the cameras. Come back and ban the cameras, and they ignored me. But I thought I'd mention it anyway, just for you.
How's the room? A very big crowd.
Yeah.
Always a big crowd. They have a show.
The show.
Yeah.
And there's one empty seat. It's, they show one seat.
Yeah.
They're disgusting.
Yeah, thank you very much. Sure are.
Thank you.
So how are we doing, everybody?
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Come can on. I take a break?
Yes, come on. Hold that.
Could you pull up that the Twitter photo now? So that was the first time we met him, and we had no idea he was going to take us out on stage with him. He like choreographed us, took us out, so it was really thrilling. And then that night, he tweeted about us. So it was a wonderful day, and as I said, because of Maria Espinosa, we went on to have four more meetings with then-candidate Trump. So we, as the Remembrance Project, are very politically focused on the government. And could you also show the next photo? It's of our Costa Mesa rally with President Trump, then candidate Trump. We are very focused, as I said, on the government. That is our target. And in California, we fight really hard. I love my state. I'm going to keep fighting. I am not moving. They're not running me out of California, no matter what. I'm going to stay and fight. But we had, in California about 3 years ago, we assumed the Republicans in Sacramento were voting the right way on all the pro-illegal bills. Not so. There was a bill 3 years ago to grant those illegally in our state professional licenses, nurses, hairdressers. Every Republican senator voted yes. When we discovered that, we were furious. So at that point, we decided we were going to get very focused on the Republican legislators in Sacramento.
It's all overwhelmed.
Yes, that's exactly. And we are a super minority now, the Republicans in Sacramento. But I will fast forward to today, and we've been working with these legislators very diligently on these pro-illegal bills. We call, we go to their offices, we go to the hearings in Sacramento. On the sanctuary state bill, every Republican legislator voted no. So we were very pleased to see that, yes, they are a super minority, but it's a start. They're voting the right way. And we did have one California Assembly member, Travis Allen, out of Southern California, Huntington Beach. He presented a bill to end sanctuary cities in California. Yes, he did. And we were very honored as the Remembrance Project. The Assemblyman asked us to join him at a press conference in Sacramento. Now, his bill did not make it out of the committee, but nonetheless, we had a great press conference, and we had a wonderful footage on Fox News. And Fred, would you show that Fox News clip, please?
Republicans in California are fighting back against Dems who want to declare the entire state a sanctuary. The first, it would be, in the nation if they were to have their way. Fox News correspondent William Lajeunesse with our report.
Well, if you're here illegally, Lou, the Trump administration considers you eligible for deportation. California Democrats disagree. They want the right to decide as a sanctuary state who goes and who stays, including criminal aliens.
This is my son. I miss his smile every day. He would never tell me, Happy Mother's Day.
Victims of criminal illegal immigrants in California are fighting back.
I do not want another family member to have to live the hell, the pain and suffering that I live with every day.
That's why on Tuesday, Republican Assemblyman Travis Allen introduced a bill to stop California from becoming a safe haven for criminal aliens.
First, it would stop state funds from going to any California jurisdiction that claims to be a sanctuary or has sanctuary policies in place. Secondly, it would direct California's law enforcement to cooperate directly with federal immigration officials.
Draconian immigration policies do not work.
Allen's bill counters Democrats' attempt to protect all illegal immigrants, including violent felons.
Child abusers, drug dealers, stalkers, people guilty of sexual battery.
Today we come together to announce the launch of a $10 million L.A. Justice Fund.
That fund uses taxpayer money to defend criminal aliens. Allen's bill would stop that expenditure, not just in L.A. and San Francisco, but the state as well.
We will not tolerate it. We live by one rule of law. We pay our taxes for the Constitution to be covered.
So the Allen bill died in committee. So the current California sanctuary bill protects everyone but convicted violent felons, meaning those deported in the past, those convicted of multiple prior misdemeanors, those charged with violent felonies but are pled down to something else or lesser. They get to stay. And Hawaii is now considering a nearly identical bill. Lou, back to you.
So that bill did go down to defeat, but it almost felt like a victory that day. We had a really good turnout. We had this great press conference, and we were on fire because we felt like help was on the way with the new Trump administration. And that's just a photo of us during the press conference. And a little bit of good news, Travis Allen is running for governor. So we are very, very happy to report that. There are people in this room that are part of our activism. Our group, as I said, we're grassroots, and we are very active. We are at Congress members' offices, city council meetings, county meetings. But we know most people can't join us, so via social media, we would ask you to join us. For example, if we're going to a Congress member's office, we are asking the nation to make a phone call. If we're going to a city council meeting, please call. So there's much you can do just with your phone and that alone. Like Paul and Stuart and Rick, we have a great amount of activism in this room where you can, again, just use your phone. Now, that was a defeat, so to speak, but we do have victories in California. We really do, and it's very wonderful when we have a victory. We have been very active in trying to influence cities and sanctuary city policies. For example, a few cities that proposed sanctuary city policies that failed, that we were at a town called Glendora, Claremont, Riverside. And I will say in our activism, sometimes we get a little edgy. We never break the law. But in the next YouTube video, I'm going to show you a dramatic event that we did. We were going to the city of Riverside. They had proposed a sanctuary city policy. And we have a very professional, very serious member, Betty Robinson. So she was going to present our side against the sanctuary city policy. But secretly, we decided at the end, we were all going to stand up and rip the policy up. So I'm going to show you that video next. This is Riverside, California, that had the great outcome of the city said no on a vote of 4-1 not to enact a sanctuary city policy.
Since her murder, I've been keeping a list of those killed by illegal aliens only a year and a half ago. It's difficult to obtain information on immigration status because that information is purposely suppressed. Therefore, the 93 people on my list are actually many times more. And any person on this list could be your mother, your aunt, your uncle. I'm certainly assuming that State Senator Kevin DeLeon's family members that he admitted are here illegally are not killers. But is it worth one person's life to ignore our immigration laws? It goes without saying that illegal aliens are attracted to sanctuary cities. Truly, with great respect for this city council, this is what we think of the proposed sanctuary city limits.
Well, I guess it's going to stall on us. At any rate, it was very exciting. We all stood up. We're tearing up the policy and the mayor gavels. He's going to end the meeting if we're disruptive. But it was, as I said, a little edgy, but we were trying to make the point just how much we oppose that bill. And again, we had a victory that night. It was sweet. Thing I would like everyone to remember in this room, more than 4.5 million Californians voted for Trump. 4.5 million. Now, double that voted for Hillary, but that doesn't matter. That's a lot of people, and we don't have a voice. That's why we as activists are using YouTube, we're using Facebook, we're using Twitter to get our voice, our opposition, our resistance, the true resistance, out to the public. And I'm just going to close with one last video. I hope it works. Again, we try to affect policy. That is our issue, is we focus on the government, local, state, federal. We work with groups like Numbers USA, FAIR, CAPS, and we really want to see our immigration laws enforced. But in closing, we attend what is called the Los Angeles County Civilian Oversight Commission. We attend these meetings, they're monthly meetings, and our group goes to advocate that immigration laws be enforced in the county. That is our stance. Well, when we first started going to these meetings, we discovered they were not saying the Pledge of Allegiance. So one of our members, Raul Rodriguez, who through the Remembrance Project also heads up America First Latinos, he asked the chairman before the meeting, can we say the Pledge of Allegiance? And no one would really give us a straight answer. So Raul, during his public comments, he asked again, and the chairman said no. So Raul had the audience stand up, and he led the Pledge of Allegiance. But the good news is, and this is what we want to do, we want to affect policy. After that meeting, they put the Pledge of Allegiance on the agenda. Every meeting, item number 2 is now the Pledge of Allegiance. So I want to show that as an example of how we want to affect the body politic. We want to make change. So Fred, hopefully our Pledge of Allegiance video will run okay.
Yes, my question is, do you intend on doing the Pledge of Allegiance? That's
sir,
yes or no?
You're here to make public comment.
Okay, we are going to say the Pledge of Allegiance. Can you please stand up? You are a disgrace.
Here we go.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
They did not stand up.
Thank you.
I can't believe you didn't stand up, any of you.
You're a disgrace. These are my comments. You're a disgrace. You didn't even stand up for the Pledge of Allegiance.
So I want to end on that positive note where we affected a permanent change. And again, our group is very active, but we need people just to make phone calls, go on Twitter, go on Facebook, and there's a lot you can do just by using your telephone. Thank you.
Thank you.